This is going to be the overview for 1 Corinthians. So 1 Corinthians means ornaments. And it's a book of what not to do. If you can't learn what to do from people, then learn what not to do. Look at what they're doing and they're screwing everything up. Say, well, they may not be showing me anything that I can do, but they're showing me something I shouldn't do. Now, this epistle has 16 chapters, 437 verses, and around 9,489 words. The author is the Apostle Paul. Okay, our three applications. Historically, Paul addresses the worldly ways of the church at Corinth. This is a worldly church showing you what not to do. Devotionally, examine yourself as you read 1 Corinthians to avoid being a worldly Christian or a worldly church. Doctrinally, the epistle of correction. Paul has to correct some things. Now, chapter 1. What's going on in chapter 1? The Corinthians are struggling with division in the church. So that's what chapter 1's about. They're divided over who baptized who. In 1 Corinthians 1:2, it says, "And to the church of God, which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of the Lord, call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours." So this is the local church at Corinth. "And to everyone in every place that call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord." So it's also to me and you. Now come down to verse 10, he says, "Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that y'all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment." Okay, the problem with the Corinthians is that they are big babies, they are very carnal, and they had a lot of division going on. Division from the world. If you're dividing from the world, that's a good thing. But division among Christians, among other Bible believers, is not a good thing. There are times when we need to separate from other Christians. But we should all be living right and believing and teaching the Bible correctly so that there is no need for any division. But he says in verse 11, "For hath been declared unto me of you, my brethren, by them which are of the house of Chloe, that there are contentions among you." So there are divisions and there are contentions. They're fighting. There's a lot of strife going on. And the Bible says in James 3:16, "For where envying and strife is, there is confusion in every evil work." This makes lost people look at Christians and just laugh. When they say this Christian is over here fighting with this other Christian about doctrine and just biting each other's head off. They just laugh and mock. He says in verse 12, "Now this I say, that every one of you saith, I am of Paul, and I of Apollos, and I of Cephas, and I of Christ." So the Corinthians were going around saying, "Paul is my teacher." "Oh, really? Well, Apollos is my teacher." "Oh, yeah, well, Cephas, which is Peter, is my teacher." And then another would say, "Y'all just follow men. I'm of Christ. I only follow Christ. I only follow the Bible." But Paul says, "Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were ye baptized in the name of Paul? Were you baptized in the name of your favorite preacher? No. You were baptized in the name of the Lord. Why does it matter who baptized you?" Paul says in verse 14, "I thank God that I baptized none of you but Crispus and Gaius." Paul is glad he didn't baptize any of them. He said, "Lest any should say that I had baptized in mine own name." So Paul did baptize some. He was baptized himself. And he says in verse 16, "And I baptized also the household of Stephanus. Besides, I know not whether I baptized any other." So he baptized the household of Stephanas as well. But he says in verse 17, "For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect." So he did baptize some, but that wasn't what he was sent to do. He was sent to preach the gospel. And if he was sent to preach the gospel, but not to baptize, then that would mean water baptism isn't part of the gospel. And that water baptism doesn't have anything to do with saving anybody. Because if it did, then why was he sent not to baptize? So for someone to say, if you want to be saved, you need to believe and be water baptized, they're just simply adding to the gospel. Paul says in verse 18, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God." So the people who perish, as in dying their sins, to them the cross is foolish. They don't understand how a man could die 2,000 years ago, shed his blood 2,000 years ago, and it still have saving power today. They don't understand that. It's foolishness. But to us, we know it's not foolishness. We know it's the power of God. Now, chapter 2. In chapter 2, Paul talks about worldly wisdom versus real wisdom. The world's got a lot of stuff that sounds like it's just so wise, but it's not real wisdom. Paul didn't have that type of wisdom. He has real wisdom. In 1 Corinthians 2:1, "And I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God." Paul didn't come trying to show off his knowledge. He had a lot of knowledge. He was a Pharisee of the Pharisees. He was smarter than all the Pharisees. He got saved and then became the smartest when it came to the things of God. The Lord revealed to him the mysteries. He says in verse 2, "For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified." You see, you don't have to show people how smart you are, because then you get the glory. When it comes right down to it, make the emphasis on Jesus Christ. And this doesn't mean don't teach the whole Bible. It just means you can bring Jesus Christ into every conversation. The Bible is his word. The Bible is full of types of the Lord. The Old Testament is full of prophecies of the Lord. When you keep Jesus Christ the main thing, you won't ever make it about yourself. It says in verse 3, "And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling, and my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power." So Paul could have dazzled them with enticing words of man's wisdom, which he knew it all, but what would that do? I mean, he could come in there like Dr. Phil and give worldly wisdom and basically just state the obvious and get his own TV show, but he came in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. And most people come in demonstration, emphasis on demon, they come in demonstration of the world. Verse 5, "That your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." He doesn't want the Corinthians to put their faith in the things this world considers wisdom. Most people who are highly intellectual and geniuses in this world base everything off of this world, like the world's all there is. They give you the wisdom of man. They know nothing about the Bible. They don't care about the Bible. But Paul says in verse 13, "Which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual." Paul is giving the things which the Holy Ghost teacheth. We all have our favorite teachers, but everything that teacher said should be filtered through the Bible. You need to compare spiritual things with spiritual. You need to compare verses. You need to search the scriptures daily to see whether those things are so. Let the Holy Ghost become the final say. Take a verse in Corinthians and cross-reference it. Get the full understanding that the Bible can give you. It says in verse 14, "But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned." The natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God. He doesn't get them. It doesn't do me any good to explain the major doctrines of the Bible to a lost person. They need to be saved first. I just talked to a woman recently that said she isn't saved, but she wants to read the Bible for herself and learn the Bible for herself. She said she just doesn't understand it. Well, the problem is that she isn't going to understand it until she gets saved. I mean, you can learn some of the facts and stuff, some of the historical things, but you won't learn the way a saved person is going to learn the Bible. It says, "But he that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man." This is a great verse that shows that judging isn't wrong. And if we didn't judge things, then how do we come to the conclusion if something is right or wrong? The Bible warns against hypocritical judgment in Matthew 7. But judging itself is a good thing. It says, "He that is spiritual judgeth all things." Remember that last time, next time somebody comes up to you and says, "Judge not, lest you be judged." Well, let's judge not that you be not judged, but we are supposed to judge. We just aren't supposed to do hypocritical judgment. In chapter 3, the Corinthians are divided over who won them to Christ. In chapter 1, they're divided over who baptized them. In chapter 3, they're divided over who won them to Christ. It says in 1 Corinthians 3:1, "And I, brethren, came not, and I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ." So the Corinthians are baby Christians. And if you're a new convert, then you are a babe in Christ. Many people who have been saved for 40 years are still babes in Christ. They haven't been feeding on the Word of God so that they can grow. They're just, it's like you go into your baby's room and he's bigger than the crib. He's got hairy arms. He's got a beard, but he's got a pasty in his mouth, and he's wearing a onesie. So, you've been saved 40 years, you could still be a babe in Christ. But it doesn't make any sense to stay a babe in Christ. He says in verse 2, "I have fed you with milk and not with meat. For hitherto you were not able to bear it, neither yet now are ye able." Paul could only give them milk. Just like a baby can't eat a big steak, the Corinthians wouldn't be able to handle the meat of the word. Hebrews 5:12 through 14 says, "For when for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat." A lot of you should be teachers already. I mean, you've been saved 40 years. You're a man. You should know more Bible than most people in the church put together. "But you have need that one teach you again. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe." Do you not have any skills in the word? "But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil." You've not exercised anything, spiritually speaking. It says in verse 3 of 1 Corinthians 3 and verse 3, "For ye are yet carnal. For whereas there is among you envying and strife and divisions, are ye not carnal and walk as men?" So envying, strife, and divisions are carnal stuff. So they're fleshy and worldly. They aren't for the spiritual man. And James 3:14 through 16 says, "But if ye have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work." See how bad that is? Earthly, sensual, devilish. See, the devils get in church. In 1 Corinthians 3:4, "For while one saith, I am of Paul, and another, I of Apollos." Are you not carnal? It's carnal to go around with complete loyalty to one sinful man and to pretend that everyone else is a false teacher or not as good because they don't follow that same sinful man. That's just respective persons. In 1 Corinthians 3:5, "Who then is Paul, and who is Apollos, but ministers by whom ye believed, even as the Lord gave to every man?" So the Lord gifted us with pastors, teachers, and evangelists. He gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ in Ephesians 4:11-12. And when you add in the envy, strife, man worship, and division over these men that God gave, it ceases to be edifying. It's for the edifying of the body of Christ. That's everybody that's saved. 1 Corinthians 3:6, I have planted. Paul says, I have planted. Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. Paul did some planting. Apollos did some watering. God is the one who gave the increase. All we do is plant and water. This guy does some planting of the word. We do some watering. God is really the one who does the work. It says in verse 7, so then neither is he that planteth anything, neither he that watereth, but God that giveth the increase. The one who did the planting and the one who did the watering are nothing special. It's God that's special. Now he that planteth and he that watereth are one. And everyone shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. So you're going to get your own reward for your own labor, and this will be at the judgment seat of Christ after the rapture. While the tribulation is taking place on this earth, you will be at the judgment seat of Christ. You won't be judged for sins at the judgment seat of Christ, but rather you'll be judged about your Christian service. And that's what you, another thing you see in 1 Corinthians 3. 1 Corinthians 3:11, it says, for other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. So when you get saved, your foundation is Jesus Christ. Now it's time for you to build on that foundation. The moment you get saved, you begin to build your building. And you're going to present this building to Jesus Christ at the judgment seat. It says in verse 12, now if any man build upon this foundation gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble. Okay, what are you building with? Gold being the best? If gold's the best, gold, silver, and precious stones, if those are the best things, then that's what's going to make it through the fire. Are you working for the Lord at all? Are you working with the right motive? Are the things you're doing giving glory to God? Or are they to give glory to yourself? The good things you do, it's going to be gold, silver, and precious stones. That's what's going to make it through the fire. That's what you'll get rewards for. If it says in 1 Corinthians 3:13, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. Notice that phrase, of what sort it is. Okay, there may be good works that you've built with, but what was the motive behind it? What sort is it? 1 Corinthians 3:14, if any man's work abide, which he hath built their own, he shall receive a reward. If it makes it through the fire, you're going to get a reward. Whatever works, make it through the fire, is what you get rewarded for. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss. But he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. So the works that don't make it through the fire, you'll get nothing for. You suffer loss because your building could have been built with better material. You could have had it make it through the fire completely, but since those works, a lot of the works were no good, you suffer loss. Yet you are saved, so as by fire. You're still saved, yet so as by fire. As in the fire does not touch you. Just like Peter talked about, Noah was saved by water, but the water never touched him. So it's not you getting burned, it's the works getting burned, the works that are no good. He says in verse 16 and 17, know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy, for the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are. When you get saved, your body became the temple of the Holy Ghost. The Spirit of God lives in you. And you don't want to defile the temple. You don't want to do things in your body that are displeasing to God. But chapter 4, Paul talks to them about being stewards of the mysteries. In 1 Corinthians 4, 1 through 2, he says, let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. There are seven great mysteries or more that we need to learn, and it will keep us from getting into false doctrine. The Corinthians probably didn't know the mysteries, but Paul is urging them that if they are going to be a faithful steward, then they need to learn them and pass them on. So you need to find out what the mysteries are. I talk about them quite often. Find out what they are, learn them, pass them on to somebody else. Be a faithful steward. Paul also says in 1 Corinthians 4:7, "For who maketh thee to differ from one another?" God is the one who makes us differ from one another. We are all different and with different personalities. This is something a baby Christian can't understand. They think they have to be just like their hero of the faith. I mean, have you ever been around a kid? Everything they do, they copy somebody else. I mean, when I would say something to my daughter when she was little, she would repeat it. I mean, she's still little, but when she was really little, she would repeat everything I said. When my son starts talking, he's going to repeat everything I say. He can't talk yet, but he tries to copy the things I'm doing. If he sees somebody putting their shoes on, he puts his shoes on. If he sees my wife sweeping the floor, he wants to sweep the floor. Everything you see somebody do, he feels like he has to copy it. You don't have to copy everybody else. God wants us to be different. He's the one that makes us differ from one another. Paul says in verse 15, "For though ye have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet have ye not many fathers. For in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel." Even though the Corinthians may have a lot of people teaching them the Bible throughout their lives, they have one spiritual father. Paul led them to the Lord. In that sense, he is their spiritual father. He beget them through the gospel. So do you have anybody that you beget through the gospel? He says in verse 16, "Wherefore I beseech you, be ye followers of me." Paul says to follow him. This doesn't mean to fight and say, "Well, I'm of Paul, and he's my only teacher." Paul just knew he had the right doctrine, and they would do well to follow him. Now, chapter 5, the Corinthians have fornication problems. Notice this is the book of what not to do. 1 Corinthians 5:1, "It is reported commonly that there is fornication among you, and such fornication as is not so much as named among the Gentiles, that one should have his father's wife." So there was a man in the Corinthian church who was committing fornication with his father's wife. That was incest. And he says, "Ye are puffed up and have not rather mourned, that he that hath done this deed might be taken away from among you." The Corinthians weren't doing anything about the problem. It says, "For I verily, as absent in body, but present in spirit, have judged already, as though I were present, concerning him that hath so done this deed." Notice that Paul already judged the situation. Judging is a good thing. He says in verse 4, "In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, when ye are gathered together in my spirit with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ, to deliver such a one unto Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that the spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus." Notice this man who was doing this act with his father's wife was to be delivered to Satan for the destruction of the flesh. You see, Romans 8:13 says, "For if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die." Living for the flesh, fornicating, doing all the things the flesh wants to do that are sinful, it's just going to, if you're saved, it's just going to be lead to an early death for you. Even for a lost person. I mean, the more they live for the flesh, the quicker they're going to die, because the things that the flesh wants just aren't right. I mean, this person wore a shirt that said everything that she wants to do is illegal, immoral, or fattening. And that's about right. Your flesh wants to do things that are wrong. And somebody said, all the things that they love doing are killing them and they don't care. That's true. The things your flesh wants to do are killing you. I mean, as soon as you're born, you're on your way to death. As soon as you are born, you're dying. And when you just live for the flesh, you speed up the process. And that's why Solomon talks about in Ecclesiastes about people dying before their time. I mean, you can quicken up the process. Now, chapter 6, Paul warns against going to unbelievers to settle things when the Corinthians need to judge things amongst themselves. They're going to a civil court of unbelievers to settle things when they could settle things among themselves. He says in 1 Corinthians 6:1-2, "Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unjust and not before the saints? Do you not know that the saints shall judge the world? And if the world shall be judged by you, are ye unworthy to judge the smallest matters?" So once again, Paul shows he's for judging. And what he's saying here is that if we're going to one day judge angels, then how come the Corinthians can't judge the small matters amongst themselves? Why are they having to take their brothers and sisters in front of the lost world to be judged? You see, one day at the judgment, or at the great white throne judgment, we're going to judge the angels that have sinned. We're going to help the Lord do that. And if we're going to do that, then why would we take our brothers in Christ before the world to get the smallest matters judged? If we're going to do something as great as judging the angels later. He says in verse 3, "Know ye not that we shall judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life?" You see, the things of this life are just small matters. Going on down to verse 9, he says, "Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, but ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God." Notice the phrase, "and such were some of you." I've had people ask me, "Well, what if I got drunk after I'm saved? Does that mean that I won't go to heaven or that I lost my salvation?" Well, if you're saved, you're not a drunkard. Even if you got drunk, you're not a drunkard. Because when God sees you, when it comes to eternity, if you're saved, he doesn't see the sins of your flesh. He sees the blood of Jesus Christ. The verse said, "And such were some of you." I'm sure you've told a lie after you're saved. But the thing is, you're not a liar if you're saved. When God sees you, he doesn't see those lies. He sees the righteousness of Jesus Christ. You may struggle with some of these sins listed here after you're saved. But in the eyes of God, you're not a drunkard. You're not a fornicator. You're not a liar. You're not a thief. You're not covetous. You're not an extortioner. But I mean, if you do those things, you're going to have loss of rewards, but you're not going to lose your salvation. Paul says in verse 12, "All things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient." All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. There are some things that aren't a sin that you can get caught up in. There are some things that aren't a sin that just aren't beneficial to your spiritual growth. They aren't expedient. They aren't edifying. They aren't useful, and they aren't profitable. You can do them, but they just aren't beneficial. And whatever you do, don't be brought under the power of it. Paul said, "I will not be brought under the power of any." And then in 1 Corinthians 6:19-20, he says, "What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? For ye are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." You are no longer your own if you're saved. Just like your spouse's body belongs to you, we belong to Jesus Christ. And we need to make sure that we aren't defiling the temple that we are in.